belonging and discussing the issues that are affecting our families, our children, and destroying our communities around the world.
Of marijuana. 40 drugs up to 40 years. Wow. Even for high-end drug crimes, most countries impose sentences that are measured in months rather than years. For example, a conviction for selling a kilogram of heroin yields a mandatory 10-year sentence in United States federal court, compared with 6 months in prison in England. Remarkably, in the United States, a life sentence is deemed perfectly appropriate for a first-time drug offender. So we have these young men, early 20s, that have been given harsh sentences for being first-time offenders when it came to selling drugs. And I know so many listeners have friends and sons and brothers who have been incarcerated, even fathers, for half their lives on selling drugs. There were more than 1.5 million drug arrests in the United States in 2014. The vast majority, more than 80%, were for possession only. 80% were for possession only. Now I'm trying to understand that, how do people are being convicted more and longer sentences than rapists and child molesters? I'm having a problem trying to understand violent crimes gets less sentences than people who were caught selling drugs. You see, at year end 2013, 15% of all people in state prison were incarcerated for a drug law violation, of whom nearly 50,000 were incarcerated for possession alone. More than 50% of people in federal prison are incarcerated for drug law violation. So half of the people, I mean, to have all jails ran over with men that were not caught off of violent crimes, but for a possession charge, this is unbelievable. Almost 500,000 people are behind bars for a drug law violation on any given night in the United States, which is 10 times the total in 1980. They said on any given night, almost 500,000 people are behind bars for a drug law violation. You know, we're looking at the media today and we see that these rapists get 6 months, child molesters, people who are killing their spouses, and here on any given night, people are behind bars for drug law violation. Now, I'm not saying that if you break the law, you should not. There should not be, a penalty for that. But to give a man 40 years, 30 years, 20 years because of a drug possession charge, I believe that's unconstitutional to do that. for drug law violations than violent crime. More people were admitted to prison for drug law violations than violent crime. I see no conspiracy. During that same time frame, there were more than 30 million drug arrests. You see, people of color experience discrimination at every stage of the judicial system and are more likely to be stopped, searched, arrested, convicted, harshly sentenced, and saddled with a lifelong criminal record. This is particularly the case for drug law violations. This is the case. Convicted for drug law violation. 2.7 million children. Because it does not affect the males that are being locked away. 2.7 million children are born up in a United States household in which one or more parents are incarcerated. So not only have we have a young man spending most of his adult life behind bars for a nonviolent crime, if he had any children before he went in, more than likely these children are grown up without a father. Two-thirds of these parents are incarcerated for nonviolent offenses, including a substantial proportion who are incarcerated for drug law violations. It is reported that 1 in 9 black children has an incarcerated parent, compared to 1 in 28 Latino children and 1 in 57 white children. 1 in 9 black children has an incarcerated parent, compared to 1 in 28 Latino children and 1 in 57 white children. Such exclusion create a permanent second class status for millions of Americans. And like drug war enforcement itself, it falls disproportionately on people of color. Nearly 8% of black people of voting age are denied the right to vote because of laws that disenfranchise people with felony convictions. Sound like another way to legalize slavery, take away the man's voting rights, his rights to decent housing, employment, by sticking and put on a stamp of a felony. For those who are tuning in, thanks for tuning in to Global Talk. This is your host, Pastor LaTarsha, and we are discussing war on drugs and mass incarceration. You know, I know there are still some family members, friends that are still behind bars, serving sentences from the 80s and 90s behind this epidemic. But see, this is a big business. The largest correction corporation of America boasts 82,000 beds and 56 facilities in 19 states and Washington, D.C. The corporation has grown by leaps and bounds since its inception in 1983. for them. And then we have all of the major investment banks that are part of it, including Goldman Sachs and Company, Merrill Lynch, and Smith Barney have a stake in private prisons. Today's economic crisis has hit all sectors of the economy. But with joblessness on the rise and income plummeting, especially the stock prices of firms like CCA, the GEO Group, and other fine institutions continue to rise. You see, there are several factors that lead to an increase in private prisons. But first and foremost is the incredible number of prisoners currently in American jails. No nation on earth has more incarcerated citizens than the United States. Wow. No nation. It is reported that even China, with a population almost 5 times that of the U.S., and a well-documented history of gulag prisons and human rights abuses, cannot match the U.S. in terms of numbers. I think that little bit of information is worth repeating. I'm big on information. I think 10 years of college kind of gets you where you like information just to circulate to get to know what is going on. China, with a population almost 5 times that of the U.S., and a well-documented history of gulag prisons and human rights abuses, cannot match the U.S. in terms of numbers. Right now, there are more than 2 million prisoners in the U.S. That is roughly 740 per 100,000 citizens. Wow. People, it is built to imprison your sons, your daughters. This is a business for them. So we can not only just realize that it's a physical incarceration. Because the longer one stays behind these cage walls, it now becomes a mental cage that one has to fight to become relief from. And once one becomes locked behind a mental cage, if they do not retrain or do some transformation on their mind, guess what happens? Re-entry happens. Relapse happens. Because at some point, they become institutionalized, and that is all they know. 20 years of spending your life behind those prison walls become all someone knows. People, this will be busy. Punishment for a drug law violation is not only meted out by the criminal justice system, but it's also perpetrated by policies denying child custody, voting rights, employment, business loans, licensing, student aid, public housing, and other public assistance to people with criminal convictions. Now, where do you think they expect people to go once they are released? They have locked them out of every human right to have a decent life. What is a man's choice? What physical security, the money stopped for the doctors, the pharmaceutical companies, and guess what? It's the same way with prisons. If they have more programs to help the when the prisons come out, less chances for them to go back in, and so that's why they make it hard for when they come out. You're not really released. The shackles are still there, they just didn't do it. Because once you're released, your human rights are not restored. What do a man do who has a family? Now the survival mode kicks in, but the chance of returning to prison even goes back higher. And even if a person does not face jail or prison time, a drug conviction often imposes a lifelong ban on many aspects of social, economic, and political life. So even if this conviction is on your record, it still has put has stamped you. Basically, like you just walking around with a sign on your back anyway. Convicted. Felony. You know, no chance, no second. It's like you're walking around almost with a dart on your back and everyone sees it. This is a big business. They're not trying to give you a better life. You know, they say, I did my time, now I'm just trying to start over. They don't want to hear that. They make it hard for you when you come out here. That's why we need more programs to assist these young men and young women who have been locked away and don't know where to start over. People, we cannot even begin to understand their journey. You have a person has just given 15, 20, 30 years of their life behind bars, which is all they know. Then they come outside, and they just as strained and caged, and then it was what they were in. What options do they really have? Not too many. The prison system, the courts, they know that they have not too many options. They are banking on their return. You see, they know that by revoking their rights, it will ensure that they will have repeat offenders. They have found a way to discriminate against people of color legally. And for me, this is what I call modern-day slavery. Take away a man's right to vote, to fair housing, decent housing.
New messages received from Jay.
Good education, get a chance to get an education, to take care of his family. Sign to me is just another way to enslave people of color. Let's take a break, and as we return, I will provide some resources for those who have family members that are still behind bars, and resources to also help the family members who have someone that is incarcerated. I'm going to go to the hospital. You can find my book and documentary as well resources for your homeless organizations, women ministry, youth groups on Amazon, and you can reach me at LaTarshaHoldis@yahoo.com. I'm on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Until next time, be blessed. I look forward again for you tuning in to Global Talk Radio with your host, Pastor LaTarsha.